Okay, well, I can ask a question then. I do have one more. I have a question for you.
Okay.
One of the things I loved about your essay was the, and I see that you had to condense it out of this version for the sake of time limits for
right.
a conference, but you have this really engaging first paragraph that is all about your family's food history and all of the barbecues you have and all the specific mm-hmm. types of food you eat as part of your family's culture, really. And so that's really, I wondered if you would speak to that and whether your family has seen this and how they've reacted, if they tell you, oh, she's gone off to college and got these highfalutin ideas about food and, you know, she's too snobby for our family about barbecues now or what. And you also have a conclusion paragraph where you're like breaking up with cheesecake.
Yes, pretty much.
Which was very sad. It was like a comedy, romance comedy, a rom-com at the end there with the breaking up with cheesecake. But yeah, I'd love to hear any thoughts you have about those more personal aspects of your essay.
Yes, I've been on and off vegan for a long time, and the reason for it is I'm Hispanic, so I literally everything we eat is centered around meat and cheese, and you know, I can't eat rice and beans for the rest of my life. It's just not gonna work out that way. So one of the things that I've struggled with is definitely adapting to that, basically, and finding a happy medium and a balance between being socially capable of working with my family or having fun with my family and my friends. Because if we think about it, we really all socialize over food. You know, we want to go out and you want to have, you know, drinks and you want to eat and things like that. And it just becomes this bonding experience with food. And so we associate that with just bonding with our friends and family. And so it's been kind of a journey for me to really take everything that I've learned and really apply it. So I feel like I've learned a lot through this, but for me to actually apply it to my everyday life has been kind of a challenge, I should say. And I think it would be a challenge for anyone because we really are so used to eating, you know, when we think of barbecues, we think of hamburgers and hot dogs and, you know, potato salad and like all of these great things that we want to eat. And you know, you can't really eat those things when you're a vegan, you know, and then everyone looks at you like, what are you doing? You're crazy, you know, why aren't you eating anything? So it definitely has been difficult breaking up with cheesecake, but you know, I'm still on that journey. I'm still working on it. And I think if we can all just be a little bit more informed, and that's really the whole point of this essay, was for me to just be more informed. I don't know that I can completely be a vegan for the rest of my life. I don't know that I can commit to that. But I think that it's definitely best to be a little bit more informed about what we're putting into our bodies and learning about those things so that we can make better decisions down the road.
Well, the fact that you spoke to the social pressures around mm-hmm. eating, I was wondering if maybe Mishauna could speak to that too in her experience as a quick coach, because I'm assuming that a large part of the difficulty in smoking cessation has to do with the fact that, you know, you go have a cigarette break with friends and it's a social thing. What have you seen show up around that and with the smoking cessation social pressures?
We actually have some tools that pamphlets and some tools that we hand out to the clients to help deal with those, because oftentimes they do switch from smoking to eating or any addiction. You know, you go from one to the next. So it's very, very hard. Something that I, can we do a comment too? Or just a question? I kind of had a comment that I thought of. Oftentimes when you try something new, like with your family or with friends, or, you know, they question, why are you doing that? That mm-hmm. is weird. I recently went through the same situation with my grandmother because I was going to quit drinking milk. Like, it's foreign to them. Like, mm-hmm. nobody understands. So you just kind of have to be, you know, believe in what you learn or believe in what you read and just kind of do what's best for you. Mm-hmm. So.
I'd just like to make a comment before I go to class. It seems that there was always two camps, you know, the vegan and those that are the meat eaters. After listening to this presentation, I think it's going to be easier for me to start getting a better diet because I can still eat meat and still get healthy. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
I love the pairing of these two presentations, and like you already brought out, Missy, about, you know, somebody who's leaving one addiction may reach for something else to kind of fill that space, and likewise, some people, you know, use cigarettes or other stimulants, mm-hmm. you know, as a way of keeping away from certain foods that they feel like are unhealthy to them, and I just love the overlap between your two presentations. And one of the things that Stina can also speak to this, look for in terms of essays to be in Claro is the quality that we're looking for, a high quality of research and academic presentation, but also things that, you know, would be of benefit to the community or that they would enjoy, you know, to read, or that this information, this is a forum to spread ideas like these that people within this community can benefit from. So I was curious for both of you, as you, you know, both of these projects seem like the, you didn't just do it for class, it was something you were already interested in and part of your life journey. Have you noticed any, besides your peers and family saying you're so strange, any kind of positive overlap where maybe, you know, they didn't necessarily completely convert, but maybe passed over some of the animal products here and there, or people that you maybe didn't think would have ever made that choice, that from being around you and seeing you, probably hearing your enthusiasm about these topics as you were researching them, any kind of little sparks of spreading the joy?
When I was vegan, I definitely had better mental clarity and just overall felt better, and started losing weight without actually really trying. I mean, I was eating French fries, which are still vegan, you know, technically. So, you know, I was eating stuff that I could probably eat on a regular diet, but, you know, it's considered vegan, so it was okay. And when I started doing that, people would ask me, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "I just cut out everything but, you know, basically vegetables and fruit and grains." And I think my parents were, some of my friends were, once they saw the changes, they were kind of amazed by it. They weren't more inclined to do it themselves because they didn't think that they could do it. But they did like the progress that I had made personally. So I think if I would have carried it through a little bit longer, maybe they could have jumped on board and followed me on my journey. But, you know, maybe someday they will. I don't know. And one of the biggest things that, as far as inspiring me to create, to write about this, was cancer does run in my family. So I thought it was interesting that food itself is tied into preventing cancer. So, yeah, maybe it'll pass on.
One thing that I did notice with smokers here at Red Rocks is a lot of people became more respectful of where they smoked, or if, you know, one of us was around, or just the situations, you know, maybe to follow the 25-foot rule that we had that was kind of just ignored. I did see the more awareness that went on campus with the Quit Coach program, the more respect that, you know, there wasn't people smoking right outside of the clinic out back, or, you know, different. I did see the respect level come up with the smoke, with the people that did use tobacco.
Do we have any other questions for the panelists or comments?
I got a question for you. What's your opinion on the smoke thing you got now, the non-smoke device? Is that something that just is going to be taking over the smoking?
Do you mean vaping, like the little pens? Are you talking about that? Yeah.
Smoke pens, whatever.
Do the mic again.
Well, I'll answer as best that I can, and if Jamie needs to add in, she can. E-cigarettes and the vaping is not, and probably will not be, FDA approved. It's very hard. I did a lot of research for our program on the e-cigarettes, and it's very hard to regulate how much nicotine a person is actually getting through those. A lot of those are manufactured by the tobacco companies, and their goal is not our health. Their goal is our money. So I really believe in my heart that they won't be FDA approved. I do know that people have stopped smoking using those. There's been a lot of dangers, fires, different, you know, things happen. But at this time, as a quick coach or quick coach coordinator, I can't say that we would recommend those because they are not FDA approved. Do you have anything to add to that, Jamie?
Missy mostly covered everything that I would say about e-cigarettes. I might just add, e-cigarettes are completely unregulated. So not only do we not know how much nicotine is in each e-cigarette, it can very much vary from what it says on the package. Since they're not regulated, the companies can also add any number of chemicals, and we have no idea what those chemicals are. The other kind of worrisome thing is there have been very few studies done on the long-term effects of e-cigarette use or on the effects of e-cigarette secondhand exposure. And as Missy said, there's been a lot of accidents and things like this being reported. Also, it's very dangerous with children and pets around. The poison control has seen a huge increase in calls of children because the tobacco companies are coming out with e-cigarettes in these flavorings like bubblegum and watermelon, and you know, kids put everything in their mouths, pets put everything in their mouths, and so there's a lot of unfortunate things happening with that. So.
The vape ones that you fill yourself can be potentially fatal. It's 10 milligrams, a dose of 10 milligrams of nicotine can kill a child, and 30 milligrams can kill an adult. So if a child was to get one of those bottles and spill it, you know, on their hands, there's nothing on that that says that anywhere, but it could be lethal, so.
I actually have a question for both of you, and maybe the room can get some commentary going on this, but the last little exchange led me to want to ask about, I don't know, I see that these choices we make of what we're consuming, what we're putting into our bodies, there is a really nefarious way that we'll realize something's not right? Like we'll think, oh, okay, well we need to eat more plant-based foods, or we need to eat a more vegetarian vegan diet, right? And then you'll see all these foods crop up at places like Whole Foods that are really still highly processed, full of sugars, full of fats, but they can say on there, no gluten, no added fats, no this, you know, and make it look like it's actually a healthy thing to eat. And then with the e-cigarettes, I see something similar happen, like, oh, we know we shouldn't smoke, so the industry comes out with this other way to get our money and to keep us from actually, you know, fully waking up to this problem. So I feel like we're just a culture of consumption. We like to consume, and if we start to wake up to one method of consumption being dangerous or bad, then the powers that be that want our money find a different way to get our money and keep us consuming, right? I mean, I don't know if you guys have a comment on that or not, or if there's anything that popped up in your research or thought process around that, but it just strikes me as just endless jack-in-the-boxes. If we wake up to one level and then there's another box we're inscribed by.
That's more my comment on the e-cigarettes being manufactured by the tobacco companies. You know, they're not being manufactured by people as an NRT, you know, to try to help people. So definitely, I wouldn't recommend it to anybody. I have to say that when they first came out, I bought both of my parents one. And then all of a sudden I did all this research and I was like, no. So.
I would say, I think we just need to stick with real food. You know, the least amount of processing there is to a food, the better it's going to be for you. If you think of something that grew out of the ground, like, you know, spinach and et cetera, that's going to be better for you than, you know, eating, you know, a McDonald's hamburger or something. I don't know.
Bologna.
Bologna, exactly. And another thing to add to that, when you think about what we're told we need milk, you know, for calcium and things like that. Who's benefiting from that? the dairy companies, the ones that are feeding us these things. They're making so much money off of telling us that we need to drink milk, but we're drinking milk and we're drinking it from a completely different species of animal. They don't, no one else, no other species does that. You don't see a dolphin, you know, taking it from a lion, or, you know what I mean? Like, it's, maybe that's a little exaggerated, but, you know, you get what I'm saying. We're the only ones that take milk from a completely different animal to consume. And they're making milk for their young to feed them and to give them the nutrients for when they're born, not after that. They don't continue doing that afterwards until, you know, when they're adults. So why are we putting that in our bodies? So.
Well, and something that just popped into my head, you know, with your research with cancer and all of these things, 50 years ago, there wasn't all of the garbage put into everything, all of the preservatives, all of the, I mean, you can buy a gallon of milk that lasts 2 months.
Velveeta. Well, it's yeah. Velveeta. I mean, it's on, you know what I mean? So, it's on the, ca- you know, it's like, you don't even have to refrigerate it. I mean, what is it, you know, so.
I would have to agree with the natural.
Do we have any remaining questions for the panelists? All right, well, let's thank them for their time today. Thank you so much. I learned a lot from both your presentations. We all did. And this concludes the first session of the day. We're going to be here again at, what's the next session? Three? At 3, we have another session coming up on people in place, the effects of place on people. So hope to see you back for that one.